This is Pauline Jennings, and you're listening to Musician Talk. My guest this week is Justin London, the Andrew W. Mellon Professor of Music, Cognitive Science, and the Humanities at Carleton College, where he teaches courses in music theory, music psychology, cognitive science, the philosophy of music, and American popular music. Justin has a degree in classical guitar, master's in music theory, and a Ph.D. in music history and theory. His research interests include rhythm and meter in Western and non-Western music, music perception and cognition, and musical aesthetics. He's taught all over the world and led professional organizations. On top of all this, he plays guitar with a jazz trio. So you see, Justin definitely has the chops needed for this fascinating conversation about music and the brain. And he has a way to make all of this dry-sounding material fun and exciting, as you will soon find out. I'm honored and lucky to have him here today on Musician Talk. It's time to talk with Justin London. Hi, Justin. Welcome.
Thanks, Pauline. Good to be here.
Oh, I'm so happy you are. Came down in this windy, windy weather. Ugh. I tell you, I'm sick of it. I'm sick of the cold weather, and we get a nice day, and then the wind just takes it away. Thank you, Wendy, for setting this up. And I am going to ask Wendy to join us for part of today because it's a little bit different, seeing as we don't have a musician on that is, we're talking about their music, although Justin is a musician. We're talking about the brain and music. And I have been wanting to have a conversation with an expert because I say all sorts of, I spout all sorts of things during my show that I really don't know that it that I've read, that I've gleaned from reading here and there, and I don't know really. I'm not an expert. So now I have an expert on. So thank you for joining me today.
No problem.
So first, I want to talk about your musical journey and your academic journey and your scientist journey, which is huge, a huge ask. But if you could take me through how you got to where you are today at Carleton.
Right. Well, as we were chatting before the show, I grew up in a house full of music. My dad was a jazz musician. That was his first, well, his first love was my mother, but his second love was jazz music. And he played it as a kid through high school, but wanted to have a respectable trade, so he became a research biochemist. And then when he retired, he founded a big band, and that's still playing in the Daytona Beach area of Florida. So there was always music, lots of jazz playing in the house. But Dad was also a scientist. And so we all had, the kids all had music lessons. I grew up starting on the clarinet. I shifted to guitar when I was about 12. And of course, if you were studying music, you were having proper lessons. So I started with classical guitar lessons when I was 12. My dad, who was a gigging musician, and my mom was the singer in the band, was heartbroken when I said, "Dad, I don't want to go on in science. I want to go to music school." So I did. He said, he resigned with a sigh. He said, "All right, go to music school." And I went to the Cincinnati Conservatory, studied guitar, had an epiphany that I did not want to just teach guitar lessons because my teacher there was very good and preparing us to be music teachers, because she knew that's how we're going to make our living,
right?
And gigging. And I had some other mentors there who said, "Well, you know, you're pretty good in class. You want to stay on and do music theory?" And I said, "Okay,
why not?"
I did not have a plan. This is all just dumb, very good luck.
Nice.
And they, so I studied with a couple of people there, and then they said, who were interested in rhythm, which I found interesting, as most musicians do, although that was not a typical thing that a music theorist would study. Mostly, when you think of music theory, you think of harmony and learning how to do your chord progressions, right?
Right.
So, and they said, "Well, you need to go on," after I finished a master's, and they sent me on to this guy. His name is Leonard Meyer, who studied rhythm at the University of Pennsylvania. So I moved to Philadelphia and started working with him. And again, I wasn't fully cognizant of the fact that Lenny was a great music psychologist. So I started working with him, and then it became inevitable that my main teacher in graduate school was
kind of a music scientist. He was mostly a music, but got me going there.
Wow.
And then I came to Carleton over 30 years ago, mostly to teach music theory, but also pursuing questions of how we talk about rhythm. And one thing about rhythm is it's all a lot of it is not just what you hear, but it's what you feel on account of what you hear.
Right.
More and more I found myself wondering about, like, well, why does that sound fast or that sound slow? Or why do I feel a beat so strongly when there's nothing happening at all?
Right.
It didn't take much. I was already at the top of the slippery slope and just kept going down it, and then started hanging out with other people who researched these questions and basically morphed into becoming a music scientist. Sort of what Dad was thinking about all along.
Right, exactly.
And also I had a good, respectable job teaching at a fine, small liberal arts college.
Right.
And that's kind of how I got here.
Wow. It all came together, didn't
right.
it? It came together for you and for your father, which is
yeah.
just
yeah.
wonderful. Well, thank you for that. And you did a great job just synopsizing that. So you talked about music scientists, and that your area that you kind of started with and continue to look at is rhythm. And so what do you research when it comes to rhythm?
Right. Well, my one-sentence answer is I study the speed limits of rhythm.
Okay.
Because it turns out that, and again, scientists spend a lot of their time studying what's obvious to everybody. You know, an astronomer studies why it gets dark at night.
Right, right.
So it's like musicians and listeners know, well, yeah, it gets fast and gets slow, and they know that things can get too fast and get too slow. So, in studying the speed limits of rhythm, you want to know, well, why is it that these speed limits exist? And it turns out it mostly has to do with how fast your brain can process the information. I brought a little demo in. Would now be a good time for
that? Yeah. Before that, I just want you to explain what you mean by speed limits.
Okay. So we can play notes very fast or very slow. So the question is, when do the notes become too fast to play? Like, you know, if you told a musician, I want you to play these 1,000 notes a minute.
Right.
Well, they probably can't do it.
No.
Right. And if so, how fast can they play? But another related question is, even if somebody could play that fast, or you had a machine playing that fast, how fast could your ears keep up with them?
Got it.
That's what I mean by the speed limits. How fast can your ears keep up with them? And it's both the maximum and minimum. So also when you slow something down, there's also how slow can it go before you can't dance to it anymore? At all. I mean, not even walk with it anymore.
Got it.
So if you think of those things, those are the sort of boundaries that I'm interested in when I say the speed limits
of
music.
Okay, so go ahead now set it up for
Wendy,
us.
Wendy, could you, I have the first cue, I don't want to say.
Beethoven.
Yeah. All right, see, I should have said that.
Particularly in Northfield.
All right, well, okay. Why don't you play the first, I think it's a continuous file, so just play the first bit and then you'll need to pause it.
Of this one that I was going to play. I have separate files.
This is the Beethoven one.
Yeah, okay. Let's just call it Beethoven. We all know it's Beethoven.
It is.
Here we go.
That was kind of quiet. Very slowed down version of the same piece. It's Beethoven. The question is, which Beethoven piece is it?
Right. Oh, and it's painful.
Right.
We'll wait for the next note.
Obviously, these notes are too far apart. You can't even hear them as a tune, right?
Right.
That's the point. So how close do they have to be to hear it still as a tune, albeit a very slow one?
Right.
So this is obviously too slow. I think it's almost the agonizing slow is almost over, and then we should hear
what the song is.
Yeah, which
here it is. And there it is. We all recognize that.
Right, that the Ode to Joy from the Ninth Symphony, and realized by a very cheap synthesizer I have in my office. So the first one, you had this burst of notes that you couldn't figure out what it was.
Right.
And the second one was so slow, you couldn't figure out what it was, although you can kind of trick yourself into it. If you catch a note and then catch the next one and catch the next one, you can maybe reconstruct them, but there's no way that you're actually hearing a melody.
Right.
Right.
But you're filling in right at that point.
So it turns out that when the notes come about more than 10 notes a second, we have a lot of trouble telling what the melody is. Also, if you try and tap along with it, we have a lot of trouble syncing up precisely. You can kind of stay with it because you're probably tapping along very fast, but you can't synchronize the way you could if it was just a little bit slower. Similarly, when it gets that, really, really slow, you can't move along with it or identify it. If I give you the same try and tap along with it, when the notes are about a second and a half to 2 seconds apart, instead of being able to tap right along with them, which we can do in between, we're really good at it. People are really good at adults, especially at this wide range of tempos. But then when it gets too slow, it's like a reaction time test. You hear the note, and then you immediately try and tap or do whatever you're asking somebody to do.
Got it.
So those establish the speed limits, and it's not because musicians can't play faster. We can. Guitarists and flutists can play trills, drummers can play lots of really complicated patterns, but you can't sync up with the individual notes anymore.
Wow.
Right.
So it doesn't matter what kind of music you're playing.
No, it doesn't matter. And we've studied this cross-culturally. I do some work looking at African drummers. Other people have looked at Indian drummers and tabla players who can play amazingly fast things, right? But they're thinking not in terms of individual notes anymore. You
right.
can't think that fast. They have to think in terms of takadibi takatigada, like an entire pattern of it. That they've learned and practiced a lot.
And so if we're listening to it, the parts that are going so fast, like trills and the things that drummers do, are we listening, are we hearing them in batches as well?
Yeah, you hear them in a batch. You hear like diddly diddle. That's
right.
One thing.
Right.
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 They don't hear the did da dee la li dum.
I love that.
Right.
I love right. that. Our mind, when it becomes too much for it, we find ways to compensate.
Right. This is a general a process known as chunking, when
okay.
you have sequences of events in words in a sentence, or actually syllables in a sentence that come together to form words or clauses. You don't listen to a sentence in terms of every syllable, right?
Right.
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 You chunk it. We do the same thing with music. So the question is, how do we chunk music? So I'm looking at, I suppose to refine my description, I'm looking at the speed limits of chunking.
Nice.
For music.
That sounds like the name of a book, Speed Limits of Chunking.
I'm not sure it's a book I'd want to read, but go ahead.
Or that anybody would know what it's about.
Yeah.
Right. So along with speed and the rhythm is the beat, and there's a difference between rhythm and beat.
Right. So the beat is that when you hear music that's more or less regular, you immediately start moving with it. We sway our bodies. You tap your toe. Again, it's within those speed limits. It's actually the range for beats is a narrower portion of that, because we like to tap our toe between about 100 and 120 beats per minute, around two beats per second. It's a really good rate of activity for lots of things that human beings can do, for talking, walking, gesturing. It has to do with the size of our bodies. Little kids are fast,
right?
Because they're small, and then
so
we like that rate, and so we tend to gravitate towards doing things at that rate. So that's the feeling, the pulse, or the beat.
And so, and because human beings, as you said, have, there's this range that we all kind of fall within. I suppose there's people that fall outside those ranges,
right.
But no, but the average person falls in this range.
Yeah.
That's why we all talk kind of the same, at the same pace, and we walk at the same pace. And we evolved to do this, to be able to understand each other. And if we, our brains would have evolved differently, we might all be talking as fast as I do all the time. Or
you're from New Jersey.
Or some people actually think I am, and I've never even been there. That's fascinating. All right. So we have this beat per minute that we like to right. hang out in.
Yeah.
Right.
So that's just feeling the beat. And it's really interesting that while all people can feel a beat, you know, given a regular rhythm, people will start bobbing or tapping and they can do that. And a few other animals seem to be able to do this.
Oh, really?
Some birds seem to be able to do this. They're famous birds on the internet dancing to the Backstreet Boys that went viral. There's actually seals seem to be able to do this. There's one seal. Now, you have to work really hard with birds and seals. They don't just do it naturally, whereas little kids... Well, you know, you start playing music and they immediately start learning to dance and walk along to it, right? So
yeah.
You don't have to teach a human being to do this. What's fascinating is other primates are not very good at this.
Interesting.
So our nearest evolutionary ancestors don't have this, but we do. So the question is why and how do we do it, but that they can't do it. So beat perception is interesting. I mean, us... Since I'm interested in the speed limits of music, I'm interested in how fast the beats go. And then you have to ask the question, what's a beat?
Right.
So the beat is sort of at a regular interval where you feel something ought to happen. So we go, okay, that's interesting. And then you start like using, trying to find out these speed limits. So we would like have little drum patterns and ask people, when can you, is it too fast or too slow? And even at the sort of optimal rate, you see how precisely different groups of people can, synchronize with things. And we found, you know, musicians are better at it than non-musicians because they've spent thousands of hours learning to synchronize with each other and practicing with a metronome. Anything you practice at, you tend to get better at.
Right.
Although not that much better.
Interesting.
Right? Yeah. So
for this,
and in fact, everybody's better when you give them a stick and ask them to tap along with the stick. We're better at that than just like using our finger.
Huh.
And drummers are, of course, the best at this.
Right.
And if you take the stick away from the drummers, they're really not that much better than other
wow.
people, because all their practice, their 10,000 hours of practice, is with the sticks. They don't practice. Well, actually, some drummers
of course,
practice barehanded if you're
right.
a djembe drummer, right?
Right?
Then you are better with your bare hands.
Right.
But this is this fascinating thing. That just goes to show how specific our abilities are, which led, I'm working with some researchers at the University of Oslo. So we then did this study where we got different groups of musicians to just align a click track or drum along with looped sounds. And what we got some jazz musicians, we got some EDM producers, and we got...
electronic dance music for those of you over 50 or so.
I'm over 50.
you know what it is.
Okay.
I am too.
Right. So EDM producers, and we got folk musicians. And these are all Norwegian folk musicians, and there's a hotbed of EDM producers in Oslo. So they got these groups together. And that was the task, tap along or align a click track with it. And we had some EDM sounds. We had some jazz sounds, like jazz bass sounds, jazz drum sounds, some fiddle, folk fiddle sounds and things like that. And the fascinating finding was these different groups heard the beat in different places. They were teeny tiny little differences. Well, actually, some of them were pretty big, but they were very consistent. The experts... were not hearing the beat in the same place. The non-experts were kind of like a little fuzzier, but
sure.
the experts were really had learned to hear these things. So that meant that they really weren't hearing that note the same way.
Right. So when you, so when I think about that, okay, we all, the beat is the beat is the beat, right?
Right.
But when you really think about it and you have, let's say you're playing a song that's 100 beats per minute and the drummer's playing at one and he's, there's microseconds on either side of that,
right,
that where you're going to land on. And yeah, everybody in the band is going to land differently. And when you lock, that's when you're all feeling that beat really, really closely.
Right.
And, at the same time.
And musicians will talk about there's like a beat is like a pocket. And
yes.
In the pocket.
Yes.
Well, different notes have different shape pockets.
Interesting.
Some beats have very wide pockets. Some sounds have very narrow pockets, right?
Yeah.
I mean, everybody, for a metronome, which is just a click, there's not much pocket. So
right,
everybody pretty much does the same thing. So initially, that was what was used for research. You'd use like metronome clicks or a boop from a sine tone or a piano note.
Sure.
And everybody kind of behaved the same way. But when you start doing, well, this is a funk drumming sound, this is a jazz drumming sound, this is a jazz bass sound, this is an orchestral bass, you get different responses because it's like, oh, well, that's a fat pocket, that's a narrow pocket. And then people kind of move the pockets around. So those are these two aspects to it. It was really fascinating. And it also was, as you said, like beats are just beats, because the from the scientific side, everybody thinks you just, your ears hear a sound and we all process at a very low level the sound the same way.
Right.
We don't.
We don't. We don't. Wow.
Right. Even at a very low level.
And so when you have a folk musician playing with a jazzer, they may have a harder time feeling the groove together or get sitting in the pocket together.
Yeah, exactly. I'm nodding my head up and down, yeah, so I'm telling your radio listeners that I'm doing that.
Yes.
So, right. And the interesting thing in terms of playing together and feeling how this works is it's not just that you're different backgrounds. You know, if you've got a folk musician and a jazz musician, they actually are not hearing the note the same way, so they're having a little trouble negotiating, like, how we get the groove locked together.
Right.
But even if you get, like, two jazz musicians, we have... I remember I said we all like to feel beats within about 100 to 120 beats per minute. Well, your mileage may vary, is the technical term. And so... some people actually prefer more slower beats. You know, you ask them to just like tap along that's neither too fast nor too slow. I mean, if you ask everybody to go really, really fast, they all go about 10 notes a second because that's about how fast most people can tap. And if you ask them to go really slow, you'll get, you know, really odd things, but usually not much more than 2 seconds apart. But when you ask them to be like right the most comfortable rate, people will be different. And this is called spontaneous tempo or your preferred tempo. Well, if two people prefer very different tempos and then you ask them to play together, they're not as good at it as if you get two people whose preferred tempos are very close to each other. They have a much easier time syncing up. And of course, the best person to play with is yourself. Because, and we've done this, you get somebody to like tape one
yep,
bit and then
tracks.
And then yeah, so you like you get a pianist Gesundheit to do like left hand and right hand separately, and you have them playing not your left hand but somebody else's left hand and somebody and your own right hand, but we're actually the best at with our own left hands
playing
and right
together,
hands
right,
even when we're not doing them together, because you know your preference the best.
And when you say preference, that isn't I like fast music because I like to move, or I like small. This is what your brain, the tempo your brain is comfortable at.
Right.
Yeah.
All right. And now, of course, when you're asking musicians to do that, it's their brain has got, is the brain's running the show.
Right.
But it's also the brain that's interacting and controlling their body that has to, like, perform the actions to produce the music. So it's brain and body working together. And that's true for everybody. It's like, I like this. My brain has learned that my body likes this, like, pace for walking and talking and moving.
Right.
And then it becomes self-reinforcing that the
yeah,
more you walk and talk that way, the more your brain likes it, the more your brain establishes. And, you know, this is, we forget that this is what we were learning to do when we were 2
right,
and 3 years old.
Yeah. Amazing. Amazing. Yeah. So you have, we talked about tempo, and we talked about beat, which leads us to groove.
Yeah.
And there
it's
are,
a thing. A
groove is a thing. It's not just a feeling.
Yeah.
Right?
Yes. So there is a sub-area. Okay, so I'm in the area of music cognition and perception. That's okay. The kind of music science that I do. And then within that, some people work on how we hear pitch, and others work on how we do timbre. We're going to get to that in a minute.
Okay.
Others, and I work with the rhythm crowd, and I do the speed limits, but a number of people have worried about like what makes just our basic sense of beat, because that's still somewhat mysterious. You can play patterns where, you know, you don't necessarily have notes all the time, and yet you can hear the beat. Wendy, do you have the Hoochie Coochie Man file? Could you play that for us?
Even when there's no music.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So, I made this loop. It keeps going. Right. So, that's Muddy Waters' Hoochie Coochie Man, which I took. That's a stop time blues figure. And he starts singing after the band goes ba-bum, ba-bum a couple of times. And I just cut out Muddy Waters. And everybody is, you know, I will play this for a class or a group of people. And you can hear everybody's foot tapping on the beats 2 and 3 in between.
Yeah.
Right. Nothing's happening, but you're feeling this strong sense of beat. So obviously, first off, we're doing it. The music's not doing it.
Right.
So we're doing it. And we feel it strongly in our bodies, but also we really kind of hear it in your mind's ear.
You totally
right?
do.
Right. So it's in your head. And so this is music that really makes you strongly feel a beat and really makes you want to move. And we enjoy it. That's the kind of technical definition of what groove or grooviness is. Music that really makes you want to move in a pleasurable way. So turns out, now, I have to say that most of the people who do this like playing groovy music. So they said, well, let's study it, which means that we can listen to lots of music that's really
that's
groovy and call it research and going into work. I'll fess up to that. So Peter Giannotta, who's at University of California, Davis, is one of the leading researchers. And he did a big study, and he just had lots of different kinds of music. He had Motown, and he had jazz, and he had folk music, and he had pop music. And he had just lots of people rating them as to what music they thought was really, really groovy. And there was a winner.
Okay, I'm on the edge of my seat here.
All right, here was the, by science, scientifically determined to be the grooviest piece ever.
And while we wait for Wendy to get that set up for us,
I
want to, we're playing it from the beginning, not your clip, and we'll just cut it out, but feel when you start to, or notice when you start to feel the groove, when you start moving your body
right.
at home.
Right.
Those of you.
There is a
This is Pauline Jennings, and you're listening to Musician Talk. We just played Stevie Wonder's Superstition, scientifically shown to be the grooviest song out there. According to studies, I'm discussing here with my guest today, Carleton Professor Dr. Justin London. Okay, so when it first started, it's just the drums. This is what happens to me, is I'm moving my foot because the beat's there, and you feel it, and it's strong. But then when the when the horns come in, is it, or is it the synthesizer that
the
comes
clavinet.
In? The clavinet. Clavinet, thank you. Yeah. Comes in and it gets real funky. Yeah. Then it's not just a tapping. It's like my whole body kind of just grooving.
Right.
Right?
So what the study that I mentioned before the hour, and I have to say that this was just a good example of whenever you're presenting this stuff, you always have to stop in the middle of a song, and you hate doing that.
I know.
And that's a song where we really hate doing that.
We do. Sorry, Stevie Wonder.
The study surveyed and lots of people listening to several hundred songs, and Motown R&B was the top most grooviest. And this is just, what do you think is grooviest? What do you want to dance to the most? What do you like the most? And the people were saying yes, yes, yes to these three questions, which were mutually reinforcing. And then, you know, other kinds of pop music was right up there. So was disco. Makes perfect sense. This was all music made for dancing.
Dancing, right.
And then some jazz was good, some jazz wasn't. Folk music didn't do so well because it's not necessarily made for dancing.
Like, right.
So in looking at Superstition, it starts out with that fairly straight drum track.
Yeah.
And it's got a strong beat, and we all start tapping our toe. But it's boom, chuck, ta-ta, boom, chuck. Boom, chuck, yep. Tit the boom, chuck. And then you ba dum bum 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 bum.
Right.
That's syncopated. It has a bunch of offbeat notes.
Got it.
So what they found is asking people, again, which is groovier, which one do you like moving to the most? If you have no syncopation, it's okay. And if you have, but it's not super groovy. And if you have tons of syncopation, if it's like all over the place, then you can't find the beat anymore, and that's not
right.
Okay.
Right.
So there's an optimal amount of syncopation, and Superstition just nails it in terms of the beat's clear, there's this nifty stuff going on off the beat, the syncopated things, and then it's got other interesting aspects, layers of stuff happening when the horns come in, all of which catches your interest and helps you move. The other interesting thing about Janata's study, which I thought was terribly clever, is one of the things that helped them quantify grooviness is you could ask people their opinion and you get some information, but you know, part of that is if it's a song you really like, you're going to go, oh yeah, it's
right,
really groovy.
Right, exactly.
And if it's a song that you don't like but might actually be pretty groovy, you're going to go, nah, it's not very groovy.
Exactly.
So what he did was he had cameras on people, and they asked them to, like, would you, like, just tap the beat along to this? Yeah, they could do it. Then he asked them to, like, just freely drum along with it. That didn't work so well because most people don't practice that. So drummers were okay with that
right.
part of the experiment, but if you weren't a drummer, it wasn't so good. Then he had just sit there. People couldn't. And he would see, and the camera could see their whole bodies. They could, you know, they're sitting at a table, but he could see their feet. And then you could just see, well, how much are they moving? Well, this becomes, as we say, an empirical question. We can do the video analysis. We know what makes you move the most.
Right.
It was the grooviest song.
I was wondering about controlling that for preference of music, right?
So, right.
Yeah.
I mean, preference is a problem whenever you ask some of these kinds of questions
right.
because it's this, you've got this kind of vicious circle where, you know, if you ask somebody, do they like something? They prefer it. Why do you prefer it? Because you like it. Why do you like it? You know, or what do you listen to a lot? Well, we don't listen a lot to music we don't like.
That's for sure.
Right. So okay. then what you tend to like is similar to what you already know and like, rather right. than things. So that's why you should find all kinds of crazy new different kinds of music, because you can find other things you're going to like that then will maybe help you like other things as well.
Right.
If you just listen to the same thing over and over, it's not so good.
It's a lot easier to do that now than it was when we were growing up.
I mean,
we had our albums and we would play our albums. Now you could go songs like Carole King, you know, there's a whole bunch of music to listen to,
right,
including current stuff. So
right.
That's interesting.
Okay.
So, okay, let's move on here to, I'm so fascinated with this rhythm cognition deficit. That's what I wrote down, and I'm not sure what I was referring to there. Maybe you can...
Yeah, I remember from our previous conversation.
Exactly.
Yeah. So I kind of do pure research. We just want to, you know, understand how people get a basic grasp of some of these aspects of music. I can't do anything that's going to help a musician play better or make a music producer, you know, come up with the next hit. They already know how to do that. I'm more figuring out, well, what is it that you're doing that you already know how to do?
Right.
Not that I can tell you how to do that. But there are some practical benefits to this. When you study these speed limits of music and how well people can synchronize and not synchronize, it turns out that people who have certain kinds of movement disorders or motor disorders are less rhythmic. And so... one of the biggest area here has been studies of Parkinson's disease and how you can use music and people's ability to tap along to music as an early diagnostic tool to see if there's signs of Parkinson's.
Right.
Because there's a specific part of your brain that actually is involved in beat perception. There have been studies of people listening to really groovy music, and you put them in the brain scanner, and you can see what parts of the brain are lighting up. Well, it's the same part of the brain, the caudate nucleus and the putamen.
Thank you for that.
Yes, yes. Not everybody can go home and look that up.
Right.
That's also implicated in Parkinson's. So
okay.
When they knew that this is part of the brain which has... you know, some deficits and physical failures in Parkinson's, it's also heavily involved in beat, producing a beat if I want to make one to, like, engage in a rhythmic behavior. Or when I'm listening to rhythmic music, it also, you know, kind of resonates with it, which is why for gait rehabilitation therapy, music is so terribly effective. You literally can't produce the regular rhythm inside your brain, so you externalize it with the music, and that helps retrain right. The brain to start doing that again.
And I personally watched that happen with a friend of mine it was part of a band that we had for a while, our recordings that we did, great guitar player, got early onset Parkinson's. And so it definitely had lots of rhythm in his bones
right.
And his brain. But like you said, that area of the brain is being affected. And what happens to a lot of people with Parkinson's is they get stuck in doorways and they cannot move forward.
Right.
They can't take that next
right.
step. And he had just a little metronome on his phone. He would hit the program. He'd start hearing the beat in his head, and he could walk just fine.
Right.
Amazing to watch
right.
that happen.
So obviously your brain is not generating the beat. You
right.
need an external beat generator.
Exactly.
So this is where, you know, there's some, I think, important practical aspects to
Absolutely.
This. And there are other things as well. And it's not that music is this magical cure. I want to be just clear that there's
right.
this very specific thing that music is able to do in terms of it can provide a beat when you can't. But it also helps us understand, as we learn how the brain processes music, you're learning how the brain does lots of other things too.
Right.
So,
exactly.
Because there's always a lot going on up there.
There is.
So,
there is.
Yeah.
There's so much more here, and maybe we have to have a second second portion to the show, but so we're going to move on, but there's so many things. I'm writing down notes what we're going to talk about next time.
Sure.
But I want to move on to Name That Tune, because I want to challenge Wendy with playing the clips that I sent her.
Yeah, I did give you these clips. We should use at least some of them.
Right,
all right.
Right,
this is for both you, Pauline, and Wendy.
Okay.
Okay,
why are we doing this?
All right, so let me do, here's the setup.
I mean, other than having fun.
Yeah, well, mostly we're doing this for fun.
Right.
So we're not going to talk about rhythm anymore, as much as I could keep going on about rhythm all day.
And I could ask you more.
Right.
Many
so another aspect of understanding how music works in your brain is how we're able to tell, like, one sound from another, one instrument from another, one person's voice from another.
Right.
And the musicians use the word timbre from the French timbre, all right, or tone color to talk about they have different colors. Notice we're using like a visual thing because we can say that's red and that's green. So we think that that's a flute, that's a bassoon, that's Wendy's voice, that's Pauline's voice, right?
Right.
And we're really good at it. And as a demonstration of how good we are in music, I've prepared a list here of songs. I've got one note. Most of these are less than 1/2 second.
Wow.
Of music.
And I have 17 clips.
Right.
Do you want to give me the number?
Would you please cue up number 2?
And play it?
Play it, yes.
Okay.
All right, that's easy.
All right, what is it, Pauline?
I don't know the name of it.
Queen.
Yeah, we know it's Queen. But it's Bohemian Rhapsody.
Of course.
My favorite song.
Right, so if you know it's Queen, then your best guess is Bohemian Rhapsody. Right. I'm pleased to note that every single 18 to 20-year-old in my current class knows that's Bohemian Rhapsody.
Awesome.
This actually was, because I just did this a week or so ago in my class.
And there was the movie recently.
Yes, that did help.
That
did help a lot. Okay, let's try, since we're all sitting here, I think we're of a certain age, try number 3.
I know that one. That's the Who. Won't get fooled again?
Correct. Pauline is correct. Right. And that was one of the
most... I can see him going across the stage on his knees.
Yes. Right.
Roger Daltrey.
That's Roger Daltrey, one of the most famous screams in rock and roll.
Yes.
Never listened to The Who as a
one of my
young
favorite
person.
Bands, so...
Yeah. All right. Let's do something a little more recent. Let's try number 4.
Sounds familiar.
Try it again. Play it again, Wendy. Play number 4 again.
Is it like Pharrell Williams or something?
Not a bad guess.
I have no guess here.
All right. Almost all of my students know this one. This is Gangnam Style
by
Psy.
Oh, yeah.
And it was... Notice that has a kind of envelope to it.
It
sound
sure does.
Kind of blooms in a certain way.
I'm going to do it again.
Yeah.
Yeah, where's the beat on that one?
Ah,
there it is. Got
yeah,
it.
You could hear it then.
Once more. Okay.
All right, let me give you guys an easy one. This is a self-esteem one, number 7.
Okay.
Okay, ready? It's been a hard day's night.
Correct, Wendy, right?
We'll do one more, and then we got to move on.
I'd
like to play this all day.
All right. Do you want Feels one that good. I think you can get or one that I will challenge you?
But let's do one that we can get.
All right.
One of each.
Okay,
we'll
one
do
of
two
each.
More.
Number 6, please.
Got it. How about you? Beach Boys, Good Vibrations.
Right. And that's not only were you... That wasn't even a note. That right. was mostly the reverb from a note from Brian Wilson.
Yeah. Gosh, how do our brains do that?
All right. It's sources of sound in the world produce very characteristic sounds, right?
Yeah.
And it's and they produce a wide range of things. They don't, you know, a note... is not just like one frequency. It's tons of different frequencies for most notes, unless you're listening to an oscilloscope. It's just, there's all right. of these very rich sounds. It's the full spectrum of sounds. And we're very good at distinguishing all these different spectral identities. It helps us notice what's out there, what's it's doing. So it's a very, very basic auditory ability we have. And when we put it in a music domain, then it's like, how we're able to tell one person from another. And this is what producers do.
Ah.
You know how many different snare drum hits samples you can buy?
Right.
Thousands, right?
Right.
And what you want is within 1 second, your fans, when they are hearing, going across the radio dial or flipping through Spotify, that's, for me, it's like, that's Jerry Garcia's guitar. Right. And I need like half of one note, because you know what that sounds like. My father was a saxophone player. He, you give him one note, he could tell you exactly who was playing saxophone, especially alto, because he's an alto player.
Wow.
Right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yes.
And that's, see how that important that is and how much, how meaningful it is. Now, I could do other things, like, even if you don't know it, you would know, is it jazz? Is it country? Is it folk? Is it classical? You'd also know, is it sad? Is it happy? Right?
Wow.
From 1 second.
Our brains are incredible, right, aren't they?
Yeah.
I mean, so a note is, scientifically, it's a frequency, a frequency.
Well, it's right? a group of frequencies.
Okay.
Okay? It's a think of it as a cluster of frequencies that all tend to happen together.
A chunk.
A vertical chunk.
Oh, we're putting bookends on this.
Wendy, chunks are mostly for sequences, and these are all things that happen at the same time.
Got it.
Yeah. But we're really good at identifying sounds, especially familiar sounds, and we rely upon them all the time. And the I know we're running out of time, so he'll be today's wrap-up. We evolved to be able to do this in noisy environments. There's stuff going on. Other people are talking. Other sounds are happening. Today, the wind is blowing. Lots of white noise from that, right? And yet we can hear what's going on, figure out where it's happening, and things like that. So in order to do that, you have to be able to get at this sort of right away quick information. And it turns out timbre is a really, really powerful marker for what exactly you're listening to that's out there.
Well, I got to believe that the ability, that we evolved the ability to do this because we want to, because we have language. And so the...
Oh, that, we'll need another show for that.
Yeah.
Because the whole links with music and language is an amazingly interesting and complicated topic. But the basic answer is yes.
Right.
The fight is, which came first?
Okay.
Did we evolve the music stuff and then it blossomed into language, or did we evolve the language stuff and then the music came after because there's so much overlap between the two?
All right. We were going to have a show on that, on language and music and the brain, because I think this is just fascinating. In fact, I was, when I was doing the intro here, pre-recording that, I was thinking, well, should I say this is first in a series, even though I don't have the second one set up yet, because I want to keep talking about music and the brain. I'd love to continue it with you. I'd love to continue with other scientists that study different different aspects of this, because I find it fascinating. And also it shows us how important music is. And that's kind of the point of this show, is the importance of music and pointing
out.
You
had a quote you told me
I
about.
I did. This is Daniel Levitin, who wrote This Is Your Brain on Music, as well as other things. Music may be the activity that prepared our pre-human ancestors for speech communication and for the very cognitive representational flexibility necessary to become humans. So there you have it.
Right. And I got a quote for you, too.
All right.
Which is from Ian Cross, who's a friend and colleague who I've worked with. And he just succinctly put it, is music the most important thing we ever did?
It made us human. There we go. What a great way to leave the show. And I just want to thank you so much, Justin, for coming on. And we're going to do this again.
My pleasure, and happy to come back.
All right. Thank you. Thank you so very much to Professor Justin London for this educational and fascinating discussion. What a terrific teacher he is. Thanks also to all of you out there for listening to Musician Talk on the One, KYMN. I hope you have a terrific day.